In the last video, I spoke about how the Most High commands those who will be His set-apart people to be totally segregated unto Him from the rest of the world. I spoke about how the blasphemous religion of Christianity exists far apart from His instructions to do so. And so do those who live in the physical nation of Israel at this time. The Most High allowing for the Dome of the Rock to exist on His Temple Mount is proof of this. And so is their allowing for Christianity and Islam to coexist with them proof of this. These things testify that they are not of the truth either. I read a few days ago where the authorities of the physical nation of Israel recently bulldozed an Islamic mosque and some houses. They did so in order to clear land to build additional settlements for their people. But will they do the same with the Dome of the Rock in order to build a house unto Yahweh on His set-apart mount? Or are they more afraid of Islam and what the rest of the world will think of them than they are of the Most High? The answer to this question is obvious. If the Most High truly was their standard, they would know that He would fight for them and they would obey His command to tear down Islam's altars and their places of worship. They would do the same thing to Christianity's altars and their places of worship. But the truth is, the Most High is not their standard. Like their own whoredoms to Him, they allow for these other whoredoms to Him to exist in Israel as well. This dome has continued to stand for the 66 years since the time that the Most High began to return the people who dwell there today. The reason why is because the Most High is not their standard, and it has been allowed to stand for the over 1,300 years since it was built for a reason. It stands where it stands because the Most High has purposed for it to stand there. The people who reside in Israel that call themselves the Jewish people are far from Yahweh Elohim's set-apart people. And this dome symbolizes this. I'll expand on this symbolism in a bit. In 1948, He started returning a people who are no longer His people to the physical nation of Israel. He did so for a reason. He did so as part of His witness against the scattered descendants of Israel in these last days. His word testifies that those who dwell in Israel today are the descendants of Dan. There is a reason why the descendants of Dan are not one of the 12 tribes that are recorded in the count of the 144,000 first fruits in the revelations of our Messiah. In Israel's end-time prophecy that the Most High gave to him at the time of his death for what would fall upon his 12 sons' descendants in the last days, we are told in Genesis chapter 49, the people of Dan will contend with or strive with one of the rods of Israel, referring to our Messiah. Dan will be a serpent against the way and an adder in the path that strikes at the horse's heel so that his rider falls backwards. The descendants of Judah and Benjamin were cast out of the physical nation of Israel a few hundred years after they killed the Most High's only begotten son. Yahweh plucked them up and He scattered them into the rest of the scattered descendants of Israel. He did not do so after they killed His son. Instead, He did so after they fixed His Sabbaths on the day of Saturn's day on Satan's Roman calendar in the year 4116. 40 years after they killed His son is when He empowered a people to destroy the temple that was thought was on the mount. This allowed for the dome that exists there now to be built 622 years later. After Judah and Benjamin were scattered, He set a hook in the jaws of the descendants of Dan and that caused them to embrace their traditions, and Dan started bearing the name of being the Jewish people. And the descendants of Judah and Benjamin drifted into the captivity of Mystery Babylon along with the rest of the scattered descendants of Israel. This is all testified to by the Most High through the testimony of His word. The reason why the descendants of Dan are not counted in the 144,000 is because they also embraced Judah's rejection of the Most High's only begotten son as being the Messiah. The Elohim of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel did not return a people to His set-apart land that reject His only begotten son because He is pleased with them. This should be common sense to you. Why would the Most High return a people who deny His only begotten son? Like I said, He did so as part of His witness against the other tribes who would remain scattered until the end of this era of time. He put a hook in Dan's jaws to lay siege to the traditions of Judaism for a reason. Like the dome being allowed to exist there, the reason is symbolic. At least those who embrace the traditions of Judaism seek to obey a form of our Creator's statutes and judgments. Granted, what they observe is a perverted and profane form of them, but contrast their doing so with the desire that most of you have to do away with His instructions altogether. It is important to understand that the Most High returned this people to a portion of the promised land in spite of their rejecting His only begotten Son. His only begotten Son said in Matthew chapter 12, "He that is not with me is against me, and he that does not gather with me scatters." The religion of Judaism is obviously against Him. Even those who are in this religion that have a knowledge that He is the Messiah, who call themselves Messianic Jews, are not standing with Him in truth. If they were, they would have come out of the traditions of Judaism altogether. Yeshua was made in the image of His Father's word, and His word is truth. Standing with Yeshua is standing with the truth, and the lies of the traditions of Judaism certainly are not the truth. So if you're still holding on to those lies, you are not standing with the truth. The scattered descendants of Israel who have not returned to that which the Most High has restored certainly are not standing with the truth either. Therefore, you are not standing with Yeshua either. You help your father, Satan, keep the flock scattered by standing with make-believe images of Yeshua that have make-believe blood. Verse 31, "Therefore I say to you, man can be forgiven for all sin and blasphemy, but blasphemy of the Spirit," referring to Yahweh's Spirit, "will not be forgiven. Yahweh's Spirit is the Spirit of His true righteous character. And whosoever speaks a word against the Son of Man, he can be forgiven. But whosoever speaks against or blasphemes the set-apart Spirit, he will not be forgiven, not in this age, nor in the age that will be." Those in Judaism who obey a form of the Most High statutes and judgments certainly speak against His Son. Yet He returned them to a portion of the land of Israel anyway in order to illustrate this. You should marvel at His doing so. But just because He returned them there does not mean that He is pleased with them. This is illustrated by Him not counting them worthy to be of His first fruits. Yet He brought them back to this land in order to illustrate a point. In this point, He is mocking the scattered descendants of Israel for doing away with His statutes and His judgments altogether. He also did so in order to be a partial example of what it takes to be delivered into His promised land. It takes obedience to His word. The religion of Judaism does not obey His word in spirit and in truth. They do not walk in obedience to what Yahweh taught to their fathers. Neither did their fathers do so, except for a small percentage of them. But at least they obey what their fathers taught them to obey. There is an example of this recorded in the Most High's word that gives credit to doing so. It is found in Jeremiah chapter 35. Yahweh uses this example to condemn our rebellion to His word that He speaks through His servants, the prophets. Jeremiah was instructed to bring the house of the Rechabites into Yahweh's house and to give them wine to drink. They refused to drink it because their father Jonadab had commanded them and their sons to not drink wine. Then Yahweh said in Jeremiah chapter 35, "Thus saith Yahweh of hosts, the Elohim of Israel, go and tell the men of Judah and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, will you not receive my instruction, or will you not receive his correction, to hearken to my words, saith Yahweh?" The words of Jonadab, the son of Rechab, that he commanded his sons to not drink wine, are established. His words are raised up. Unto this day they drink none, because they obey their father's commandment. I have spoken to you, rising up early, sending his warnings ahead of his wrath, and speaking through his servants the prophets, but you have not hearkened to me. Jonadab also told his sons and his sons' sons to not build houses, nor sow seed, nor plant vineyards, nor even have them, but rather to dwell in tents. When they refused the wine, they said that they had obeyed their father in all of that which he charged them to do. And Yahweh used them for an example for their doing so, just like he returned the tribe of Dan to a portion of the promised land for their doing what their fathers bid for them to do. Jonadab's command for his children to dwell in tents is awesome in how it ties in with the here and the now. The Most High sent me to you ahead of his wrath to tell you to flee to the hills and to the mountains so that you will not be a partaker of his hot indignation. His word says that he is going to cause you to dwell in tense at the time of the end, at the time that he sends his servant, in similitudes of the prophecies that are recorded in his word? Have you hearkened to his command for you to flee? The title of this video is Bulldozing the Dome of the Rock. The Most High's allowing for this dome to exist on his set-apart mount is a powerful statement on his part. So is his allowing for it to be built there in the first place? Its existence being allowed to remain on this mount in Jerusalem for these past 66 years is him stating that he is not pleased with the inhabitants of those whom he returned there. Yet he returned them there because at least they obey a form of his instructions. His word testifies that Judah and the rest of the scattered descendants of Israel would remain scattered until he pours out his wrath. So obviously those who he returned there are not the descendants of Judah. The reason that Dan was exempted from being counted as one of the scattered tribes of Israel that would remain scattered until the time that the Most High pours out his wrath is because they were exempt from being counted as one of the tribes of Israel in the revelations of our Messiah. This is why they could be returned there and not break the Most High's word that says that Israel would remain scattered until the end of this era of time. The fact that he has not returned those of you who are the scattered descendants of Israel to the physical promised land of Israel that he gave to our ancestors testifies that you remain scattered because he is not pleased with you because of your complete rebellion to his word and your rebellion to his righteousness. Islam's dome standing in this place is a symbol of his displeasure against you. You should look upon this dome and loathe yourselves for living in such a way that would cause the Most High to allow for it to be built there and allow for it to continue standing upon his set-apart mountain. In the last video, I pointed out that at least Islam tries to uphold a form of the Most High's righteousness. At least they seek to purge out abominations like homosexuality and adultery and such from their midst. And they are not even his people that he set apart to be his, just like the tribe of Dan is not of his 144,000 firstfruits. Yet he allows for both of them to stand in the physical land of Israel at this time. You should marvel that he returned a people who reject his only begotten son to this land, yet he causes the scattered descendants of Israel who say that they believe that his son is the Messiah to remain scattered abroad. You should marvel that he allows for Islam's dome of the rock to stand on his set-apart mount, yet his word says that he is going to keep the scattered descendants of Israel's eyes blinded and ears stopped until the time that he sends his wrath upon you. This is recorded in Isaiah chapter 6. The hearts of this people are waxed fat, and I have caused their ears to be heavy, and I have shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes, and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn back and be healed. Then I said, Adonai, how long will this be? And he answered, until the cities are wasted without inhabitant, and the houses without man, and the land is desolated to devastation. The Dome of the Rock standing on his set-apart mount symbolizes that the Most High is not Israel's banner at this time. He is not the standard of those who live in the physical nation of Israel at this time, nor is he the standard of the descendants of Israel who remain scattered. Since those who are in Israel today and the scattered descendants of Israel who are spread abroad do not have the courage or the desire to conquer that which opposes his righteousness, he is going to do so for you, but not before he sends a time of great calamity upon you to humble a remnant of you into returning to him. And along with this time of calamity, not only will this dome be leveled to the ground by the Most High, so will your whorehouses and your high walls that you hide behind. What will you do when he heaps this time of trouble upon you? Will you come under his rule and return to him to let him mold and fashion you to become as he is? Will you return to his righteousness being your standard so that he will fight for you? Or will you blaspheme him instead of accepting accountability for your whoredoms to him? Sadly, his word says that most of you will blaspheme him for this time of correction, and you will die in your rebellion to him. Thus saith Yahweh of hosts, the set apart one of those whom he rules over.